Thank you so much for being here, for coming to the library, for supporting independent bookstores. They are our communities, places to gather where you actually can rub elbows with real people and have conversations you didn't know you were going to have, and maybe even discover books you didn't do a search for that just fall into your hands. That doesn't happen many places. It happens at independent bookstores. We have to support them. That's the commercial. I've been traveling around, and since this is a fairly short book, I thought by the end of my tour I probably would have read every page of it. But there are still some pages I haven't read yet. So I thought tonight, since I'm back in Brooklyn, where I started, literally, I would read a couple of sections from someone that I haven't actually read before, and then maybe one that I think I've done once or twice. There's always some part of a novel that you expect will be the first part that people will ask questions about, and then when you're through with the publication and you're back at your desk and you're working on yet the next book, it suddenly strikes you, nobody asked about that one section. This section I'm about to read is the one that I thought for sure everybody would have all kinds of curious questions about, and nope, not interested. So if you'd like to ask questions about it later, I've pointed it out to you now. You know, I thought when, after I did the tour for my last book, which was 7 years ago, this is my seventh book, and it's been 7 years since, and my editor said there's a nice symmetry to that, 7 years, seventh book, and then he said, but don't ever do that again. But I sort of came to the conclusion that when I did a tour and when I gave a reading, I was not going to teach readers how to read the book. You write the book, and then you hand it to the reader. And the collaboration is between the reader's mind and the words on the page, and you, the author, have to step away. But I'm also a teacher, and so the impulse to teach a reader how to read the book is strong. So let me just say a couple of the sections I'm going to read are about angels. I thought that was obvious, but my husband tells me, nope, you're still too subtle. This takes place fairly early in the book. I'm on page 36. Again, it's a fairly short book. This is indeed the story of a single woman's life. Marie Comerford is a Brooklyn girl, raised really across the 20th century. She's a child early in the century and lives to the end of it. She's 10 years old in this scene. Gertie is her best friend, or they are the best of best friends. Anyone who's had a best of best friends will understand what that means. There are a couple of neighborhood people mentioned. Bill Corrigan is a young man who's been blinded in the First World War, who serves as umpire. He is indeed a blind umpire for the stickball games. Mrs. Shahab lives next door, and some years before, her daughter, Peggy, had died suddenly at 17. I think everything else is probably self-explanatory. On Monday, Gertie was not in school, and when I walked by her house on the way home, a large lady was sitting on the steps. She wore an apron and scuffed black shoes, and her stockings were rolled down around her mottled ankles like circlets of excess flesh. She was cooling herself with a feathered fan, although the day was mild and damp. The woman fastened her eyes on me as I approached, and in shyness, I veered away, crossed the street, kept walking. I went around the corner and would have gone on home, except that just as I reached my own house, I was filled with the pleasant conviction that the strange woman on the steps had gone inside and the way was now cleared. I resolved to try again. The boys in the street hadn't started their after-school game yet, although some were already gathered around Bill Corrigan in his chair. One was swinging a broomstick. Walter Hartnett was tossing a pink spalding up into the air. Mrs. Shahab was leaning out of her parlor window, rubbing the outside of the glass with a piece of newspaper. She looked over her shoulder and called, "You've missed your house, Mary dear. You've walked right past it." Her name is Marie, but the neighbors don't get that. Everybody's Mary. There was no reason for me to lie to the woman, the poor woman, as she was still called 3 years after Peggine fell down the stairs, but I felt, nevertheless, an urgent sense to do so. "I'm just going back to school," I said vaguely. "I forgot to remember something." There was the smell of vinegar from the doused newspaper. "I just remembered that I forgot something." Mrs. Shahab laughed with her daughter's crooked teeth in her mouth. "Never good to forget to remember," she said. "Always better to remember you forgot." I bowed my head and hurried on, walking in a suddenly clipped and urgent way that I thought would nicely match my lie. At Gertie's house, sure enough, the stoop was empty, and a kind of confidence in my own prescience made me take the steps two at a time. But no sooner had I gotten into the gloomy brown light of the vestibule than I saw that the fat woman was now sitting on the inside stair, halfway up, tilted over a bit to lean against the banister. There would be no getting by her without first saying, "Excuse me, please." But neither could I turn around with the woman looking down at me and dart out the door. All reluctance, I put my hand to the rail and my foot on the first step, simply because I didn't know what else to do. From above me, the woman said, "You don't live here, do ye? I saw you pass by before." She had a voice like a man's, deep and smoky, with a brogue, if that's what it was, that was thicker even than the accents of the McGeevers, my father's cousins, who spoke Irish to him when they came for their interminable Sunday visits, and through their narrow mouths and unintelligible English to me. "I thought you were coming up then, but you went on," the woman said. She leaned away from the banister, straightened her back somewhat wearily, as if this conversation were a task she had been putting off until now. She touched one hand to the step beside her, inviting me to sit. The other hand gripped the feathered fan. All against my own will, I continued to climb the stairs. The woman's calves, even in the dim stairwell, were bright white, veined with gray and blue like marble pillars, the rolled stockings at her ankles as solid as stone. There was a basement odor about her, the odor of cold dirt. The apron that looped over her dark blouse and stretched across her black skirt was dim and gray, soft with wear. "I take it you're a friend of little Gertrude Hansen," she said, a small smile making her words seem warm. "I take it you're coming to call for her." A bit of light from the transom above the door might have caught her eyes as she cast them down at me on the stairs. Her short hair, carefully curled, had a goldish, grayish hue. She shook her head. "But I'm here to tell you she's gone away. Her father took her out this morning. To his people in New Jersey. There's nobody home upstairs." Now I paused. I said, "Oh," and the woman suddenly leaned back. I thought at first that she was trying to see me more clearly in the gloom, but then I realized that she was leaning in order to push her apron aside as she reached for the pocket underneath her skirt. She stretched out one of her great ivory legs as she maneuvered her free hand beneath the apron and briefly rolled her eyes to the ceiling as if to picture what it was she was searching for. And then she produced a penny and held it out to me. "Do you know your prayers?" she said. I nodded, although I knew I could not recite one if asked. The woman laughed warmly as if she knew this too. The laughter made her look younger. With the McGeevers in mind, I had expected a toothless grin, but the woman's teeth were strong and straight. "Give me your right hand," the woman said kindly, and when I struggled with the school books in my arm in order to hold out the left, she shook her head and whispered, "The right one, dearie," full of a peculiar sympathy. She placed the fan on her knee. She reached up to take my right hand from the banister. I felt suddenly unbalanced there on the dim stairs. "Get yourself down to Mary Star of the Sea," she said, "and light a candle." She pressed the penny into my palm. "Don't worry if every prayer's gone out of your head. Don't be bothered by that. a good outcome's enough to say. Light a candle and ask Our Blessed Lady for a good outcome. It only takes the asking. Her pale eyes went back and forth across my face. Despite the gloom of the staircase, I saw that the woman could read everything there. Not only the fact that every prayer had indeed gone out of my head, or that left and right still puzzled me, but also that I had already determined that I would not go into the empty church all by myself. I had never gone into an empty church all by myself. If Gertie were here, the two of us would go together. We would make a game of it, as we sometimes did on Saturday mornings, laughing at the door and then tiptoeing together up the echoing aisle, lighting the flame and leaning into our folded hands at the kneeling rail with exaggerated piousness. But Gertie had gone to her father's people in New Jersey, and the apartment upstairs was empty. The woman held my wrist and pressed the penny into my palm and knew, I could tell, that she would not be obeyed. But she asked me anyway, "Will you do that?" And I said anyway, "I will." Out on the street, I walked around the block again and climbed my own steps. Mrs. Shahab was gone, but the scent of the vinegar from her window cleaning still lingered. An Easter scent, I thought, although Easter had already passed. It was the scent of the solution we made to dye our eggs, but also the odor that pricked my nose in church when they read that part of the Passion where Jesus said, "I thirst," and a sponge soaked with wine and vinegar was raised to his lips. And then the angel in the empty tomb saying, "He's not here." Well, that's not so subtle. I mean, this woman's got a feathered fan, you know? Get it? Feathered fan. She kind of smells like a basement, like a grave. She's the angel of death, and I'm not the only one who thinks so. Or I may be. So Marie, our ordinary heroine, has encountered the angel of death at the age 10 and lied to her. That same character does make another appearance much later in the book. Marie, after a career as what's called a console, or she ironically refers to herself as the consoling angel in a brownstone funeral parlor not far from here. After doing that for 10 years, she marries and gives birth to her first child. The doctor was red-faced. His hands were abrupt. "Mrs. Comerford," he said, "you are not cooperating." Although I could not see it, I knew there must have been perspiration beaded on his forehead, because as he leaned to shout at me, a drop of it hit the sheet beneath my chin. I didn't see it fall, but somehow I heard the sound it made, and in my pain, I imagined that out of that sound, the sound of a raindrop on a dry roof, there rose more profoundly the scent of the hospital laundry, the scent of bleach on the sheet that nearly reminded me, too, of some experience in this life that I might have liked, might have loved, even, my first night with Tom under sheets that had not been dried in the sun or on a line in my mother's kitchen. But the pain was a swelling black tide that engulfed the brief, bright recollection in the same way it began to absorb the doctor's red face and the hovering nurses in white and the light in the room, daylight or electric, who could say? I had been in labor for hours and hours by then, days perhaps. I had not understood, I had not been told, the extent of the suffering involved. From the cramps of the enema to the scrape of the razor to the endless searing rise and the long aching fall of each contraction. I had sent so many entreaties to heaven by then, first that my baby would be healthy, then that I would please not die, now only that the pain might end, that I had begun to see myself as some kind of fuller brush salesman knocking on a door without hinges, without knobs. Hours, days, could it be weeks into this ordeal, I had given up the hope of getting an answer and so turned my pleas instead to my own father, who had loved me and would have wept to see me here, trussed up like a beast in a slaughterhouse, trapped under the weight of my belly, racked with pain, and now, among so many indignities, this man, this doctor, shouting angrily into my face. "I am cooperating," I managed to say, and wanted to add something shocking and bitter and profane. But the black tide was surging across memory, too. I couldn't reach the words I wanted. "You bastard, you son of a bitch, you Amadon, you damn fool." There was, somewhere beside my ear, a hiss of air. The white nurse leaned in. She held in her hand the rubber mask, offering the ether, but the doctor brushed her away with a wave of his hand. She seemed to disappear into the light. "Oh, please," I heard my own voice, not roaring out those curse words as I had imagined, but pleading, whimpering, and thin. The man leaned down again. This was not my own doctor, but one I recalled brought in sometime in the last few hours or days, red-faced, imperious, with abrupt, impatient hands. "A little pain now," he said, "for a good outcome later, for your baby, a good outcome." A bitter drop of his perspiration fell on my lip, and then he leaned across me, and his white chest absorbed like cotton the black wash of my pain. He was going to smother me, the only antidote, of course, for my suffering. Fool that I had been to think otherwise, no other relief but dying, letting go of this poor body at last, sloughing it off a shell, a doll. They could stuff it with horsehair. I would make no more entreaties. I would fall effortlessly against the solid and unyielding door. They tore me in two. Later, making a joke of it, I said I was run over by the Coney Island Express. The parameters of the pain, from breast to thigh, just about the distance between the black steel of the subway tracks. The odor of blood that filled the crowded room like the underground scent of hollowed rock and cold steel. I heard, in fact, the walloping, beating rhythm of passing subway cars just as the red-faced doctor sliced me apart without sufficient anesthesia, without any at all, I was certain, and pulled the baby out and sewed me up again so that I felt every stitch. Pain like the walloping beat, light and dark and pounding air of a passing train, steel against bitter steel, a train passing over me, cracking my hip bones and rattling the teeth in my china skull. "Unnecessarily withheld," two of the nurses said later as they bathed me and changed my dressing and returned my limp body, still mine, it seemed, to a bed on the ward. They spoke softly, looking over their shoulders to the door and the hallway outside. "He had his training in the army," they told me. "He had a bad war." "Cruel," they said of him, "brutal." They said, "He thinks women need to be more stoic about these things." But when the doctor came into the room again, they only smiled and bowed and then scattered like pigeons when he shouted his demands. I saw my mother in a chair by the window when I opened my eyes again. My mother wore her hat and her pale broadcloth summer suit, and she held her purse on her lap. The slatted sunlight had washed her of all color. I thought for a moment that we might both have died during the long days and nights of my ordeal, not because of the pale light in the blank room, but because of the sweet assurance I felt waking and seeing my mother there, that I was loved, cherished beyond all reason. The peace of this, the stillness of the room, the temporary suspension of pain seemed evidence enough that I had come to the end of time. I felt a strange elation, and then I closed my eyes and slept again. It was evening, and the light was low, and Tom was in the chair when I next opened them. And then a parched morning, the sound of trays and rolling bassinets and babies crying here and there, the sound of the nurse's voice as she leaned over me, all of it furred and fiery. I had an unshakable image of red flocked wallpaper growing like fungus over my tongue and down my throat. They threw whatever covered me aside, but there was no relief in the chill I now felt on my damp skin. The wide bandages were ripped from what was left of the poor, pale flesh suspended between the thin bones of my hips. There was the sweet, pungent odor of pus. There were barked orders from the military doctor, or perhaps this was another one, more indifferent hands running over my flesh, no indignity in it anymore. I had grown so accustomed to it now. A broad nurse with gold curls beneath her cap washed my naked body with a large sponge, running the thing up and down over my extended arm, extended because the nurse had lifted my hand and clamped it under her own armpit in the casually efficient way a busy woman hanging clothes holds a clothespin in her mouth. She ran the sponge up over my shoulders and between my breasts. The nurse wore a damp apron over her uniform, and her fat arms were as cool and solid as gray marble. There was the faint smell of vinegar in the air. Not subtle, right? That is not subtle. It's right there. I'll do another brief one. This is very close to the end of the book. Marie is in middle age. Her brother Gabe, who was briefly was a priest and then left the seminary, has had what they called euphemistically in those days a nervous breakdown, and has come back to Tom and Marie's house to recuperate. This is his first night after getting out of the hospital. Later, Tom spoke out of the darkness. It was the middle of the night. He had gotten up for some reason, had the phone rung, and now he was back in the room, leaning over, his breath warm. He was whispering or crying. I came awake to realize he was crying. "It's Tommy," he was saying. "Our Tommy." "Tommy's drowned," he said. I could barely make out the words. He hadn't put on the light. His head was heavy now against my shoulder. "Drowned or driving," he was saying. "Drunk driving," I heard, and I heard myself say, "Oh God." I got out of the bed, aware in the darkness of the heavy weight of him on the mattress. He was crying, speaking. They were bringing him home, he told me, through the night, bringing the body home. And I put my hands over my ears at the phrase. I would not hear it. I found myself in the living room where the dull street light came through the crisscross curtains in grays and whites. I had forgotten to draw the blinds last night, and now there was a nightmarish tinge to the couch and the coffee table and the lamps, the family pictures on the wall. The sound of my own entreaties, which I might have been speaking out loud, wasn't at all speaking out loud. Make this a dream. Oh God, too terrible, too cruel. But it was the very cruelty of it that made me know it was real. Brutal and cruel, the way of all flesh. But to lose a child was the worst of it. I fell to my knees. There was the smell of dust on the bare floor. I could hear my brother Gabe coming down the stairs, sleepy and afraid. Good Lord, what's wrong? I had my head to my knees, and from somewhere in the darkness I could hear the girls' careening voices asking, but putting off with their questions the answer they feared to hear, some general devastation. "Don't put on the light," I begged my brother as he came down the stairs. "Tommy is dead, my child. They are bringing his body home through the night." "Good God, good God," he said. There was wailing from other rooms. "The body was coming home," I heard someone say, and I put my hands to my ears. It was a terrible word used this way. How could it be that I had never heard it before? The cruelty, the stupidity. Why hadn't Mr. Fagan, in all his wisdom, banned the term from the funeral parlor? The body, stuffed with horsehair. The child, warm in my arms, how could I bear it? Gabe pressed his hands to my ears. "This can't be real," I said. "Tell me it's not real. Make it not real." I had him by the sleeve. I pulled at his sleeve. I said to Gabe, but he was full of sympathy and utter helplessness. "Impossible," I heard him whisper. He was crying, weeping. "Impossible," he said. I was alone. No one had turned on a light. "You could ask," I said. My throat ached. "Ask." I woke slowly to the darkness of the bedroom and the steady hum of the summer fan, which Tom had turned up during the night. I felt the ache in my throat that told me I had been crying in my sleep. The house was silent. Tom was snoring softly beside me. It took a few seconds for the dream's grief to fall away, so real and terrible. I had had such dreams before. My throat still ached with how real it had been. I wiped my wet cheek with the heel of my hand. It was the middle of a summer night, and my husband was asleep beside me. It had been nothing more than a dream of disaster. Over-anxious mother, dream of disaster. Mr. Fagan's girl, hearing in my dreams the long-settled echo of other people's grief. Plus dinner table talk of Tommy and Jimmy diving in and out of the salt ocean day after day, hung over and carefree. Still, it was a terrible thing to say, the body. Still, I had asked, and it had been given, his life restored. Still, tonight I would have Tom call the restaurant where both our sons worked and tell them to get themselves home for dinner this week. Your mother is worried, Tom would say. He would know just how to put it, both joking and sincere. The women must be humored. Come home and give your mother a chance to look at you. I sat up, reached for my glasses, stood. I walked out into the living room where I saw I had indeed forgotten to close the blinds against the coming morning's heat. The slatted streetlight was exactly as I had seen it just moments ago. I could smell the summer dust on the bare floors and each of the family photos on the wall, professional portraits already looking dated, graduation pictures from a time already past. Each was stamped with the same distorting darkness I had seen in my dream. I paused at the foot of the stairs. The walls of the room were lit with lozenges of streetlight, long rectangles in a thin cross. From the bedroom upstairs, I could hear my brother breathing in his dreamless sleep. I climbed slowly. When I reached the top of the stairs where it was darker, I slid my bare feet cautiously along the floor, some intimation of how I must walk now in my blindness. I looked into the boys' room, which was dimly lit by the streetlight, the two narrow beds neat and undisturbed, the scent of boy about it still, but tempered now with the warm breeze, the odor of the day's heat against the roof. I looked into the second room where Gabe slept, the windows open, a night breeze stirring. Gabe was on his back under a white sheet, his arm thrown over his eyes as he used to do. He was awake, and he whispered into the darkness, "Marie," as I entered the room. "Are you all right?" I asked him, and he answered, "Fine. And yourself?" Which made me smile. I sat on the edge of the bed, felt him move his long legs to accommodate me. "Bad dream," I said, and recognized as I said it my own foolish certainty that it had not been a dream at all. I had asked, and it had been given to me. Time had relented, doubled back on itself, restored what had been lost. And a few more angels before I conclude. Let's take Marie right up to the end. We started out when she was 10. Here she is. The figure in the doorway was squarely built, broad-shouldered in his long white t-shirt and with a wide, dark head, but not tall, and decidedly pitched to the right. "Can't you sleep, Marie?" he said. "No," I told him. "Would you like some hot milk?" A smiling lilt to the words. "No," I said, resisting the charm of it. I heard him sigh, saw him tilt a little farther to the right, leaning, I supposed, against the doorframe. "Is there anything at all I can do for you?" he said. There was some golden light, hallway light behind him. There was a lamplight from behind my chair that touched his white t-shirt. He had told me at some point that he had found a cardboard box of them, size XXL, on the side of the Grand Central Parkway, and now he wore them every day to work, fresh and clean, a little too long, perhaps. He was not a tall man, but broad and strong, although somewhat misshapen. He had had scoliosis as a child. He had told me this, too. Like most of the workers here, caregivers, they called themselves, he was from one of the islands and spoke with a lilt that was often both beautiful and incomprehensible. "I'm fine," I said. "If you're the caregiver," I sometimes said, "am I the caretaker?" But they didn't understand the joke. Would you like to get back into bed?" he asked, and I lifted my hand. Sleep eluded me in the way so many things had begun to do. Recollections, sound, vision. I had grown weary of waiting for it. No, I said, I'm better off in the chair. I think you would be better off in the bed, he said. And I told him I had 4 children, 6 grandchildren, and each one of them did an excellent imitation of my mother. He should try another tactic. With the way my eyes were and the way the hallway light shone behind him, it was impossible to see his face, but I heard his laughter. 2 small children, who were not real, stood beside him, leaning against the hem of his oversized shirt. It was a trick my eyes had begun to play on me, figures appearing here and there, mostly in my peripheral vision, strangers, children in old-fashioned clothes, sometimes nuns in long habits, or women with babies in their arms, a clean and lacy light all about them. When I told my own children about this, they either nodded impatiently, well, if you'd had that corneal transplant, or commiserated with false enthusiasm. Maybe it means you're gaining some vision. Even with my diminished eyesight, I knew they were exchanging let's be tolerant looks. Once I asked them, impatiently, an impatient patient, why do you think every mystery is just a trick of the light? But my caregiver here in the doorway in his oversized t-shirt, found in a cardboard box on an access road off the Grand Central Parkway, I knew all his stories just as he knew mine, called these illusions angels. The consoling angels that appeared to only the few in their old age. He said, I saw them because I had once saved someone's life. Some island superstition, I thought, or a tactic from the caregiver's manual, but closer to what I wanted to believe, to tell the truth. Still, I told him he was very much mistaken. I said, I had worked at Fagin's funeral parlor until my first child came along. I was the consoling angel in those days, I said. I helped bury the dead. I didn't save a one of them. Now he asked me, his hands held to his sides as if to place them on the illusory children's heads, will you call me when you're ready to get into bed? Will you do that at least so I can help you? I said, I will. And the silence that followed told me he knew I lied. I saw the children move into the room. If you ask, he said softly, you know I will do it for you. You only have to ask. And then he disappeared from what was left of my vision because my eyes suddenly brimmed with foolish tears. I suppose I stood then because he caught me as I fell. Thank you. Thank you. Here's an interesting little tidbit. This is the wonderful part about hearing from readers. Just yesterday, I had an email from a woman who read that section and said that her father, after he had a stroke, eventually he died from, he saw children describe just much what Marie was seeing, only his were in Civil War clothes. And it said little black girls with cornrows. And he said, that they never say anything. They come into the room. I know they're not real, but I see them. And they're in old-fashioned clothes, and they come in and out. And she had written this all down, and her father was an archaeologist, which is sort of lovely, that these were the visions in his last days. And she wrote everything down, and she sent it to a psychiatrist friend of his who never responded. So she was writing to me to see if I had some neurological explanation for why these children. And I had to say, oh, gee, I just made that up.